Hello everyone. Welcome to the series of lectures on the course Calculus and Numerical Methods. This is part 1 of the third chapter, Limits and Continuity. In this session, I will introduce you all to limit of a function at a point, and we will look at few examples and a couple of theorems based on limits of a function at a point. So before getting into the definition of limits, let's look at one or two definitions. I have already introduced neighborhood of a point in the earlier chapters, so I will just rush through it quickly. Supposing A is a subset of R, which is an interval. Okay, I am taking an interval A in R, and supposing small a is a point in the interval capital E. Then delta neighborhood of A, denoted by n delta of A, is defined as the set of all the points in the set A such that mod x minus A is less than delta. Now, as we know, we have already seen what is modulus of a real number. This simply means the distance between x and A is less than delta. Okay, so if A is here, then I am collecting all the points in A which are at a distance less than delta, right? So supposing delta is this distance, so A minus delta, A plus delta I'll have here. So all those points in A which are lying here, okay, those points, collection of those points form a neighborhood of the point A, okay, sometimes also called as delta neighborhood of A. And this is of the form mod x less than delta, so I can use this property from the first chapter. So I can write this as minus delta less than x minus A less than delta, and you add A throughout, so that will give you set of all points x in A such that x lies between A minus delta and A plus delta, right? Just add A throughout here and you get this, and this is nothing but the open interval A minus delta comma A plus delta. So I am looking out for all the points in A which lie in this interval A minus delta comma A plus delta. Okay, so and these points, collection of these points form the delta neighborhood of the point A, right? Now if you see this neighborhood, the picture that I have drawn here on the real line, the point A is also a part of the neighborhood of A, right? Now if I remove that point A from this neighborhood, this is the neighborhood of A, if I remove this point A from here, then the neighborhood, the collection of all the points that are left, is said to be a deleted neighborhood of A. Okay, so I'll just state the definition of deleted neighborhood. Deleted neighborhood of A, I'll use the short form NBHD for neighborhood. Okay, so deleted delta neighborhood of A is set of all points x in A such that this condition will remain the same, but this number x minus A cannot be 0. That means I am not taking x equal to A, right? So this has to be strictly greater than. That is the only difference, and it is n delta A difference A. Okay, and this neighborhood is called the deleted neighborhood of the point A. So only difference between a neighborhood and a deleted neighborhood is that in deleted neighborhood we remove the point A, that is the central point A. Okay, so other than A, all the points are there. So it is all these points here, A is not there, and all the points here. Alright, so all these form, all these points, they form the deleted neighborhood of A. Okay, Next, let's see what is the limit of a function at a point. Let J be a subset of R, which is an interval. Okay, a subset J of R, which is an interval, and let small a be a point inside the set J. Okay. Now, supposing f is a function from J difference A to R. Now, when I say J difference A, the function f need not be defined at the point. Okay, it may or may not be defined. So, J is an interval here. The domain of the function is this interval J, and possibly this point A is not there in the domain of the function. So, the function f might not be defined at the point A. Okay, then we say that limit of the function f as x tends to a exists. We say that limit x tending to a f of x exists if there exists a real number r in R, if there exists a real number L, there exists L in R such that given any epsilon positive, such that given any epsilon positive, you give me any epsilon number, a real number positive that you like, then corresponding to this epsilon, there exists another real number delta positive. Okay, corresponding to this epsilon positive, there exists a delta positive, which is a real number, such that whenever you take a point x inside the subset J of R, whenever you take a point x in J and that point x satisfies this condition, that is, it lies in the deleted neighborhood of E. Okay, so whenever you take a point in the deleted neighborhood of A, that is x, this should imply that whenever the difference x minus a lies between 0 and delta, this should imply that the difference between the value of the function at the point x and the real number L is less than epsilon. Okay, so given any epsilon positive, no matter what epsilon positive you give me, I can produce a delta positive such that whenever x lies in the deleted neighborhood of E, that is, this condition is satisfied. Okay, that means you pick up a point x in J such that absolute value of x difference A lies between 0 and delta. This should imply that the difference between the value of the function at the point x, that is f of x minus the real number L, is less than epsilon. Okay, so if you can find such a real number L which satisfies this condition, then we say that limit of the function f as x tends to a exists. Now, this point A, it might not be in the domain of f. Okay, so I'll make a small remark here. Note that the point A might not be there in the domain of F, right? So the function might not be defined at the point A. Okay, or even if the function F is defined at the point A, F of A might not be equal to L. Okay, so remark. The function f may not be defined at the point small e. Okay, and even if f is defined at a, when I say may not be, it may or may not be. Okay, and when if the function f is defined at the point a, then f of a may not be same as l, may not be equal to l. Okay, and if this limit exists, then this real number l is said to be the limit of this function, and we write limit x tending to a f of x is equal to l. Okay, and we say that limit of the function at the point a exists and the limit is equal to the real number l. All right, now let's try to understand the definition of limit of a function at a point geometrically, and let's see what it says geometrically. Okay, so I have this definition with me, so let me plot that function f. Let me go a little, let me draw the graph slightly bigger. And supposing the subset J is here, okay, and supposing these are the points in J, that's an interval. So supposing this is J and I have the function defined from J difference A to the set R. Right, so it is defined on this. So let me draw the graph of that function, and before that the point A is inside the interval J, so let me mark the point A somewhere here. Okay, so let's say this is the point small, and supposing the function f that we are talking about is, let me draw the graph of that function. So let's say it is somewhat like this. Okay, so let this be the graph of that function, and what we say in the definition is, whenever this difference is less than delta, okay, that means whenever if I go back to the previous slide, yeah, here, whenever you take points in this neighborhood, it actually means that you are taking points from this interval, right, a minus delta comma a plus delta. So whenever you take let's say this is a minus delta is somewhere here and a plus delta is somewhere here. Okay, so whenever you take points in this interval here, a minus delta, a plus delta, and let me mark the real number l here corresponding to the point a. Remember that function f might not be defined at the point a itself. Okay, so this value is not actually, might not be equal to f of a. Okay, so let's say this is l, and supposing this is, let me give some notations to them. So that's let's say might not be same as this. And I have epsilon neighborhood of L. So let's say epsilon is somewhere here, L minus epsilon and L plus epsilon. Okay, so these points are L plus epsilon and L minus epsilon here. So that's the epsilon neighborhood of L. So what it says is, if you give me some delta positive then whenever I pick up points in this neighborhood, a minus delta comma a plus delta of a, that time what should happen is the corresponding images of the points in this part, a minus delta comma a plus delta under the function f, will be sitting inside this neighborhood L minus epsilon comma L plus epsilon. Okay, if you go back to the definition, that's what it says. Okay, let me show you that. Yeah, whenever you pick up points x in the delta neighborhood of A, the corresponding images, that is f of x, will lie in the epsilon neighborhood of the point L. That's what it says. Okay, so given epsilon positive, if I give you any epsilon positive, then if you can find a delta positive such that whenever you take points x in the delta neighborhood of A, the corresponding images of x, that is f of x, will be sitting inside the epsilon neighborhood of A. If such a thing happens, then we say that limit of this function as x tends to a exists and it is equal to this real number L that we have picked up. Alright, so that's what I mean by limit of a function at a point. Now let's see some notations which will be handy in the things to come. So let me put down the remarks here, the notations. The first one, if the real number L is the limit of the function at the point A, if L is the limit of f of the function f of x at the point A, then we write this as, then we write limit x tending to a f of x is equal to L. Okay, you all must have seen this notation in your lower classes. Then we write limit x tending to a f of x is equal to L. Okay, so that's the notation. And one more way of writing this is, you all must have seen this way as well. Second way of saying this is, we say that f of x tends to L is x tends to E. Okay, the value of the function f of x goes towards the number L as the value of x goes towards the point E. Okay, and we write this as, and write this as f of x tends to L is x tends to E. Another way of writing the point one. Okay, so this is the most common notation, limit as x tends to A f of x is equal to L, and one may use this as well. Okay, now let's look at few examples based on this definition of limit of a function at a point. Okay, so I'll give you a function and we will use this definition to find its limit. Okay, so the first example, let f, small f, be a function from the set of real numbers to the set of real numbers. Let f be a function from R to R defined by f of x is equal to c. That's a constant function. C is a constant. Okay, so every point is mapped to c by this function f. Okay, so show that limit x tending to, let's say, 2 f of x is equal to c. Okay, you must have seen in your lower classes that the limit of the constant function is that constant itself. Okay, and this is what we will show. Okay, so if you wish to take some real number instead of c, then you are free to do that. Okay, I am doing it in general for any constant c. Okay, so if the c is confusing you, then you can pick up any real number, any constant function you like, and you can proceed. So I want to show that limit x tending to 2 f of x is equal to c. So if you compare the definition, then let me write it. This is L, that is the limit. This is the function f, and this is the point A that we had in the definition, right? And this is what we want to show. So supposing epsilon is for some positive number. Okay, supposing epsilon is some positive number which is given to me. So I know what is epsilon. Some epsilon positive is given to me. Corresponding to this epsilon, we have to find a number delta. Okay, corresponding to this epsilon, we have to find a delta such that whenever x difference a, that is x difference 2, is less than delta, f of x minus c should be less than epsilon. Right? Then we say that limit of this function as x tends to 2 will be equal to c as per the definition. So we have to choose a delta here, so I will leave that blank for now. We will come back later on and fill up this. Okay, we will come back later on and we will fill up this. So let x be a real number which satisfies this condition. So if you go back to the definition and see, this is what I am assuming. My j is the set R itself now, and I pick up a point in the domain of the function, that's j, and this condition. Okay, I am picking up the delta neighborhood of E, so I've picked up the delta neighborhood of 2 here, right? And what I have to show? F of x minus L, that is c, is less than epsilon. I have to find such a delta for which this will work, right? So we have to estimate this difference, f of x minus c. Okay, then f of x minus c, this difference is the function f of x is defined to be c itself. So this is nothing but c minus c, and that's 0. And 0 is always less than epsilon because epsilon was a positive number. So no matter what delta you pick up, okay, no matter what delta positive you pick up, f of x minus c will always be less than epsilon because f of x minus c is 0 and epsilon is a positive number, right? So the choice of delta is irrelevant here. You can pick up any delta you like and that delta is going to work well. Okay, so this is the simplest case that you can come across for a constant function. So let me pick some delta, any positive I can pick up, let's say 100 I can pick up now, which is a positive number, right? So if you choose delta equal to 100, whenever x minus 2 is less than 100, f of x minus c will be less than epsilon. Okay, so you can pick up any positive value for delta that will work in this case. Okay, I just picked up 100 randomly. You can pick up any positive number you like and that will work. Therefore, what we have shown is, given epsilon positive, I have found there exists delta greater than 0 such that x is in R and x minus 2 less than 100 implies f of x minus c is less than epsilon. That's the definition of limit of a function at a point. And this says that the point c itself is the limit of the function. and therefore limit as x tends to c f of x is equal to c. So we have shown that the constant value c itself is the limit of that function. All right, moving on to one more example, second one. Let's look at the identity function. Let f from R to R be a function defined by f of x is equal to x for each x in x. Okay, so every point is mapped to itself. All right. So what we have to do is we have to show that limit x tending to, let's say, 7, f of x is equal to, what will be this limit? That's the identity function, so this limit will be 7. Okay, and this is what we have to show using definition. So let's prove this. Supposing epsilon is a positive number that's given, any arbitrary positive number, let epsilon greater than 0 be given to. So we have to choose a delta, which I don't know at this stage. So let this be blank for now. Okay, we need to pick up a delta based on that epsilon, of course. Then what we have to do is, whenever you pick up a real number x which lies in the delta neighborhood of the point 7, f of x should lie in the epsilon neighborhood of the point 7. That's what we need to show, right? So let's prove that. Let x be a real number which satisfies this condition. X minus a is 7 here, less than delta. Okay, in this delta neighborhood of 7, deleted delta neighborhood, you can say. So this is the point a that we are talking about here. Let me put that in the red, and this is the point a. Okay, so that's what we have, and now we have to estimate, we have to find a delta positive such that f of x minus l will be less than epsilon. Okay, so we need to estimate this quantity f of x minus l. So now what is f of x minus l? F of x is defined to be equal to x for each x in R. So that's x, and l is nothing but this 7, right? So instead of this l, I can directly say it's 7. Yeah, so this is already positive, x minus 7, modulus of that is always positive, right? So, and it is already less than delta from the previous step, that's the assumption step. So mod x minus 7 is less than delta. So this number now, f of x minus 7, modulus of that, which we had to show is less than epsilon, is already less than delta, right? Sorry, this is not equal to, this is less than delta. So if I pick up delta equal to epsilon, then I am done, because epsilon is a known number that's given to me, correct? If you give me an epsilon, then I will give you a delta. So the epsilon is known to you. So if you choose now delta is equal to epsilon, which is positive because epsilon itself is positive, then this delta will be equal to epsilon, and hence f of x minus 7 will be less than epsilon. So this implies f of x minus 7 is less than epsilon. So what we have done, you give me any epsilon positive you like, I can choose delta is equal to the same epsilon that you give me, and it will satisfy the definition of limit of a function at a point. Okay, therefore I can state, given epsilon positive, there exists delta which is equal to epsilon itself, which is positive, such that x belongs to R and it satisfies this condition, that is, it lies in the deleted neighborhood of delta, will imply f of x minus 7 is less than epsilon. And this tells us that the limit of this function as x tends to 7 is 7 itself. Okay, and hence proving the given statement. Next, we have the theorem on uniqueness of limits. So this says, let J be a subset of R which is an interval, and let A be some point in J. Let f from J difference A to R be a function. Then the limit of this function f of x at A, if it exists, is unique. Okay, so limit of a function at a point A, if it exists, will definitely be unique. A function cannot have two different limits at a given point. Okay, so let's try to prove this. I want to show that this function has unique limits at the point A. So we will assume that it is having two different limits, and we will show that they are equal. Okay, so let L1 and L2 be limits of the function f of x at the point A. Okay, at the point A. Then our claim is L1 is same as L2, and hence the limits will be unique. This is what I have to show. Okay, so we will make use of the definition of limits to prove this. Supposing epsilon is some arbitrary positive number which is given to us. Okay, now L1 is the limit of the function f at the point A. So by definition, what do we have? Since limit x tending to a f of x is L1, that's given to us that L1 is the limit. For this epsilon, I can find some delta 1 positive such that whenever x lies in J and x difference a is less than delta, this will imply f of x minus L1 is less than epsilon. I can call this as some, let's say, star, right? Similarly, we are also given that L2 is another limit of the function at the point A. So again, I can find one more positive number, let me call it delta 2, such that whenever you pick up a real number in the set J, any point in the J you pick up which satisfies the condition that this is delta 1 here, it lies in the deleted delta neighborhood of A, delta 2 neighborhood of A. This should imply that absolute value of f of x minus L2 is less than delta 2. Okay, so we have found now two real numbers, delta 1 and delta 2, and condition star works for delta 1. And the condition double star works for the real number delta 2, right? So this is what we have. Now somehow I have to conclude that L1 is equal to L2. If you think of this geometrically, then it will look somewhat like this. Let me have the function. Supposing that set J is here between these two points. And then I'll have my function here somewhat like this. Okay, just a rough figure. And supposing A is the point here. So I will have, supposing A minus delta 1 is here, and A minus plus delta 1 is here. Okay, that's the delta 1 neighborhood of A. And corresponding to this, I will have the point L here. and I'll have this neighborhood L plus epsilon L minus epsilon. Right? That's what we have. Now delta 2 will be one more real number. So that could be either bigger than or smaller than delta. Right? So let me put that in red. Supposing delta 2 is a number smaller than delta 1. So delta 2 neighborhood will be smaller compared to the delta 1 neighborhood. Okay, so let that be a minus delta 2, a plus delta 2, the red one. Right? And corresponding to this delta 2, we will have this epsilon neighborhood. So for each epsilon, we are assuming that there are two deltas, delta 1 and delta 2, for which the definition works. Right? Now, if you see, all the points which are there in the delta 2 neighborhood are also there in the delta 1 neighborhood. And if you see the points which I have marked in red, for those points, both the conditions, star as well as double star, work. That means I have to pick up the smaller neighborhood, the smaller delta, okay, and that smaller, that means the minimum of delta 1 and delta 2. And for that delta, both these conditions, star and double star, will work. Right? So what I will do is I will pick up the minimum of delta 1 and delta 2, and I will choose delta to be minimum of delta 1 and delta 2. Alright, so delta is the minimum of delta 1 and delta 2. Then for this delta, both the conditions star and double star will work. Right? For this delta, which is the minimum of delta 1 and delta 2, both the conditions star as well as double star will work. And therefore, if you pick up x in j, which lies in this delta neighborhood of E. Okay, for this delta, this will imply both these things will work. That is, f of x minus L1 is less than epsilon and f of x minus L2 is less than epsilon. Okay, so that's what I have. So let me put it down. And f of x minus L2 is less than epsilon. Okay, so this estimate I have. Now I have to show that L1 is equal to L2. So let me look at their difference, modulus of their difference, L1 minus L2. And I already have these two estimates with me. So what I'll do is I'll add and subtract the function f of x. Okay, so L1 minus L2. I will add f of x and I will subtract f of x. Right? Then I will rearrange these terms as f of x, or you can say L1 minus f of x plus f of x minus L2. Okay? Then by triangle inequality, if you think of this as A and this as B, then this will be less than or equal to L1 minus f of x plus modulus of f of x minus L2. But this modulus is same as, I can reverse the terms there, f of x minus L1 plus absolute value of f of x minus L2. Right? By triangle inequality, I have this. But whenever x lies in J and x lies in this delta neighborhood of A, I have an estimate for these two quantities. Both of them are less than epsilon. So I can apply that fact here. So, therefore, x belongs to J and x lies in this delta neighborhood of A implies mod L1 minus L2, which is less than or equal to f of x minus L1, plus mod f of x minus L2, and by the conditions here, both of them are less than epsilon, right? From here, both of them are less than epsilon, so I can use that here. So this will be less than, strictly less than epsilon plus epsilon. So this will give me 2 epsilon. So what I'll have to do if I want epsilon at the end here? This has to be epsilon by 2, and this has to be epsilon by 2, and then I will get epsilon here, right? So I have to make the changes accordingly here also on top. So this has to be epsilon by 2, and this has to be epsilon by 2. But from where these terms are coming, you still go higher. So this has to be epsilon by 2 here. And this also has to be, no, sorry, this is not delta 2. That's epsilon by 2. It was epsilon. It was supposed to be epsilon. Okay, so that is also less than epsilon by 2. Yeah. So what did we prove? Mod L1 minus L2 is less than epsilon. Okay, which implies mod L1 minus L2 is less than epsilon. And epsilon was any arbitrary positive number. For every epsilon positive, this will work. Okay, so mod of a real number is less than epsilon for every epsilon positive. That will happen if and only if that real number is 0, which implies L1 is equal to L2. So if you assume that a function has two different limits, L1 and L2 at the point A, then L1 is equal to L2. Okay, and that shows that a function must have a unique limit at a given point if it has the limit. Alright, so this proves uniqueness of limit of a function at a point. So that's it for this session. And these are my references. Thank you.